Hello guys, welcome back to Pirates of Medicine. Today we are going to solve the biochemistry base together, the Croc 1 medicine biochemistry base. Before we start, I would like to indulge in a cliche statement. If you liked the previous video in anatomy base and if you find this one helpful, please consider subscribing to the channel and please consider sharing this video with your friends so that it can be beneficial for them too. So without any further delay, let's begin with the base. The first question in the base is that after consumption of a fat-rich food, the patient has nausea and heartburn, steatorrhea. This condition might be caused by so-and-so. So, steatorrhea is the presence of excess fat in feces. Why will there be excess fat in feces? Impaired digestion or absorption can result in fatty stools. So, the important aspect of fat absorption and digestion is number 1, emulsification of fats, number 2, digestion of fats, number 3, absorption of fats. So, if any of these things is impaired, it will lead to steatorrhea. So, the first one is impaired emulsification. Bile acids are responsible for emulsification. So if there is a hepatic insufficiency or if there is an obstruction of the gall ducts or the bile ducts, it will lead to impaired emulsification and hence fat won't be emulsified and hence not digested. They will be present in the stools. Next we have pancreatic insufficiency. So imagine if the pancreas is responsible for secreting lipase, the pancreatic lipase is insufficient and not synthesizing that enzyme. Again, disorder of digestion leading to steatorrhea. Last part, disorder of absorption. Small intestines, microvilli, mucosa is responsible for absorption. So if there is a disease impairing the absorption like celiac disease or IBS, it will lead to absorptional disorder leading to steatorrhea again. Now there are also some medicines that block fat absorption, for example orlistat or Vytorin, and this can also lead to steatorrhea. That's all about steatorrhea we need to know, and bile acid deficiency is the only probable answer in all this option, and that's it. So let's go to the second one. The second one is the galactosemia is revealed in a child. Consideration of glucose is not considerably changed. They are asking what enzyme deficiency has caused. So to understand this, let's focus on the galactose metabolism first. Galactose, we all know, is a blood sugar present in milk products, for example. So when galactose comes into the blood, or specifically it goes to the liver, it undergoes galactose metabolism. So what enzymes are responsible for galactose metabolism? First of all, we need to convert the galactose into galactose-1-phosphate. The enzyme responsible is galactokinase. Kinases are ATP-dependent enzymes and they add a phosphate group to the molecule or the substrate they act on. Then galactose-1-phosphate is formed. Next, it combines or exchanges with the UDP glucose with the help of galactose-1-phosphatidyl uridyl transferase. This enzyme is also abbreviated as GALT enzyme. So these get change interchange, UDP galactose is formed and here glucose 1 phosphate is formed. This glucose 1 phosphate undergoes glucose metabolism. This UDP galactose, on the other hand, can form lactose in mammary glands, for example, but galactose, here UDP galactose, goes to synthesis of GAGs, glycosaminoglycans, glycolipids and glycoproteins. So this is the main part of galactose metabolism. So the main two enzymes, galactokinase, galactose-1-phosphate uridyl transferase, are the main enzymes, and if these enzymes are deficient or impaired, they lead to a condition known as galactosemia, increased amount of galactose in the blood. So the most important enzyme here is galactose-1-phosphate uridyl transferase. Deficiency or mutation in the gene that codes for galactose-1-phosphate uridyl transferase, the GALT enzyme, leads to classical galactosemia or commonly referred as galactosemia. What happens is this enzyme is not working, so this will accumulate, galactose-1-phosphate will accumulate, galactose will accumulate, leading to many symptoms. Galactose 1 phosphate accumulation in liver, nervous tissues and kidney leads to many manifestations. Like in liver, it can cause liver diseases, hepatitis, fatty degeneration of liver, cirrhosis. In the brain, it can cause neurological disorders. It can cause cataract because galactose, with the help of aldose reductase enzymes, get converted into galactitol, which accumulates in the lens of the eye, causing cataract. So galactose 1 phosphate is the most toxic substance in galactose metabolism, leading to the symptoms. So treatment of galactosemia would be galactose or lactose free diet. Now the mild form of galactosemia is galactokinase deficiency. It leads to galactosemia and galactosuria, presence of galactose in urine. But galactose 1 phosphate is not accumulated because galactose 1 phosphate is not formed. Just galactose is accumulated. Now galactose can get converted into galactitol. So in galactokinase deficiency, cataractic symptoms are seen, but the other symptoms due to galactose 1 phosphate are not seen. So it is a mild form of galactosemia. Correct? So I think that's it with the galactosemia. So galactosemia is revealed. So galactosemia or classical galactosemia is due to deficiency of galactose 1 phosphate uridyl transferase. It is not D, because when we refer to as galactosemia, galactosemia is actually classical galactosemia. So if there is galactosemia written anywhere, you can take it as classical one, which is due to deficiency of the GALT enzyme, galactose 1 phosphate uridyl transferase. So that's it with the galactose metabolism. Let's go to the next one. Next one we have is synthesis of phospholipids is disordered in the fat infiltration of liver. So we need to indicate which of the present substances can enhance the process of methylation during phospholipid synthesis. So fat is responsible for metabolism of many substances. One of those substances is fats. So think of the liver as a factory, and the blood is the transport mechanism which is throwing the substances into the liver so that they can undergo metabolism. So fats are being dumped into the liver and they undergo metabolism in the liver, forming other compounds. The problem is that when that factory gets shut down due to any machines getting destroyed or machine getting deficient in their work, it will lead to accumulation of those substances coming from the back. So if fat metabolism gets impaired, then there would be accumulation of fats in the liver. It is called as fatty infiltration of the liver. So to make sure this doesn't happen, there are some people with a checkboard, as you can see in some factories, which make sure that the conveyor belts keep going on. So lipotropic factors are substances that hasten the removal or decrease the deposition of fat in the liver by interacting with the fat metabolism. Some examples of the most important lipotropic agents are choline, the methionine, inositol, glycine, betaine, folic acid, and vitamin B12. So back to lipotropic action of methionine. How does methionine do that? Methionine, as you all know, is an amino acid. In its metabolism, it is converted into S-adenosyl methionine by the enzyme methionine adenosyl transferase. Now this SAM is actually a methyl donor. Methyl donors are the substances which acts as a intermediary in a reaction which help to donate methyl group. So in methyl transferase reaction, SAM takes part, donating methyl group to the substrates, and in turn it gets converted into S-adenosyl homocysteine. So the important fact here is, how does methionine impart a lipotropic action? How does it save the liver from deposition of fat? What it does is in phospholipid synthesis and in other reactions of fat metabolism, it methylates specific substances, leading to moving of the fat metabolism in a fashion that there is a decreased fats in the liver and more compounds are formed which are not harmful for the liver. So in phospholipid synthesis, it methylates ethanolamine to choline, phosphatidyl ethanolamine to phosphatidyl choline. So in this way the reaction moves forward, leading to a decreased amount of fats in the liver. So this is why the answer is methionine, because it is the only lipotropic substance in this, in these options. And it, and they have also mentioned that the process of methylation during phospholipid synthesis, which is done by methionine. Okay, the next one, the next question we have is about glycogenesis. They are talking that characteristic signs of glycogenesis is muscle pain during physical work. So the blood exam reveals hypoglycemia. So they are asking about what congenital deficiency of the enzyme is there. So to understand this, we need to analyze the glycogen and glucose metabolism. Glucose and glycogen are the using form and the storage form of energy in the body. So glucose is the simple sugar, and glycogen is actually a branched structure, the storage form of glucose. So when glucose is being converted into glycogen, it is known as glycogenesis. If glycogen is being destroyed to form glucose so that the glucose can be used for this function, it is glycogenolysis. So let's start with glycogenesis. Glucose, with the help of glucokinase, forms glucose 6-phosphate, which help of phosphoglucomutase forms glucose 1-phosphate. The phosphate group changes the site. Then with the help of UDP glucose phosphorylase, the glucose 1-phosphate gives out the phosphate group and forms UDP glucose. Now these many molecules of UDP glucose combine in a branched fashion with the help of glycogen synthase and branching enzyme to form glycogen, and they give out UDP in every branch. So this is how glycogen is formed, a network or a branched structure of many UDP glucose. Now when we need glucose, this glycogen needs to be destroyed. So what happens is the enzyme called as glycogen phosphorylase, it adds a phosphate group leading to formation of glucose 1-phosphate with the help of debranching enzymes. The branch structure is destroyed with the help of debranching enzyme. Now the branch structure has two kinds of bond, alpha 1,6 and alpha 4,6 bonds, which one bond help in linear joining and one helps in vertical joining of the structure. Imagine a badminton net. Correct. So glucose 1-phosphate is formed with the help of phosphoglucomutase, which is a reversible reaction. Glucose 6-phosphate is formed, and in liver and some other tissues, glucose 6-phosphatase is an enzyme which convert glucose 6-phosphate back to glucose. So this is how glycogen metabolism goes. So there are certain diseases of glycogen storage leading to increased amount of glycogen in the body. So these glycogen storage diseases are due to deficiency of certain enzyme. So first we have glycogen storage disease number 0, aglycogenosis. This one is due to deficiency of glycogen synthetase. So what happens here is glycogen is not being synthesized. So actually there is not accumulation of glycogen in this case. This is why it is 0, not 1 or 6 out of the main glycogen storage disease. So glycogen synthase deficiency leads to aglycogenosis. Then we had the von Goerks disease, guys. Von Goerks disease is the first glycogen storage disease. It is in the liver, intestine and kidney, and it is due to deficiency of glucose 6-phosphatase. So the glucose 6-phosphate is not being converted into glucose back. Next we have Pompe's disease. Pompe's disease is not actually present in this cycle. Pompe's disease occurs in the lysosome. So you can remember this, that the second glycogen storage disease is due to the deficiency of acid maltase in lysosome. The enzyme acid maltase. Acid maltase is also responsible for glycogen metabolism in the lysosomes, but it is present in lysosomes and hence it is not seen in the normal glycogen and glucose cycle. So the third glycogen storage disease we have is the Corey or Forbes disease. As I told you, there are two kinds of branching bonds. So the debranching enzymes which breaks the alpha 1,6 bonds leads to Corey or Forbes disease. The debranching enzyme that breaks 4 to 6 alpha bond leads to Anderson disease or the glycogen storage disease number 4. In the liver and the muscle, there are two types of glycogen phosphorylases, the muscle glycogen phosphorylase and the liver glycogen phosphorylase. So depending on the location and depending on the enzyme present there, there are different diseases. For example, if muscle glycogen phosphorylase is deficient, it causes McCordle's disease or glycogenosis 5. If it is deficient in the liver glycogen phosphorylase is deficient, and it causes the Hirse disease or glycogen storage disease number 6. So that's all. Now, if glycogen is accumulated in the blood, it will lead to decrease in glucose level. So the characteristic finding in glycogen storage disease is hyperglycogenemia, or you can say increased glycogen in the blood, or hypoglycemia, decreased amount of glucose in the serum. So let's go to the next one, or back to the question itself. So in this question, there is glycogenosis in muscle. So it is McCordle's disease, which we call as muscle glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is deficient. Good. So let's go to the next one. Next question is about acidosis and alkalosis, the disturbances in pH of the blood. So we have that an infant has apparent diarrhea resulting from improper feeding. So there is a plentiful excretion of sodium bicarbonate in the diarrhea. So they are asking what type of disorder it is. So let's go back and understand acidosis and alkalosis a bit. There are four main forms: respiratory, metabolic acidosis, alkalosis, respiratory acidosis, alkalosis. So respiratory acidosis, because it is acidosis, there is a decrease in pH and there is an increase in carbon dioxide concentration in the blood. The partial pressure of carbon dioxide is increased. Next, in respiratory alkalosis, we have pH increase, but there is more partial pressure of oxygen or part of oxygen in the blood as compared to carbon dioxide, which is increased considerably, causing a shift of pH to the alkaline side. Then we have metabolic acidosis. The pH is decreased again because of acidosis, but the carbon dioxide levels are normal, but instead carbonate levels are increased in a ratio that either they are increased than the acidic counterparts, or the acidic counterparts are decreased, leading to metabolic effects. So for example here, imagine in diarrhea that bicarbonate ions, which are basic in nature, are being secreted out of the body, which will lead to higher concentration of acidic substances in the body, leading to metabolic acidosis. In diabetes mellitus, ketone bodies are accumulated, which are acidic, leading to metabolic acidosis. Lactic acid accumulation in the body again causes metabolic acidosis. Similarly, its counterpart, metabolic alkalosis, there is increase in pH and there is increased concentration of bicarbonate, which can be either due to increased retention of bicarbonates or due to increased excretion of acidic substances, for example seen in vomiting. Correct. So that I think sums up the metabolic and acidosis in a simpler fashion. So here bicarbonate ions are being excreted, leading to increased acidic substances in the body, which is metabolic acidosis. Sixth question is that the methotrexate, a structural analog of folic acid and a competitive inhibitor of dihydrofolate reductase, is prescribed for treatment of malignant tumor. So they are asking on what level does methotrexate inhibit synthesis of nucleic acid. They've already mentioned that methotrexate inhibits DNA synthesis. They're asking at what level. So to understand, let's talk about dihydrofolate reductase, which the methotrexate is a competitive inhibitor of. So this is a mononucleotide of uracil. It is going to be converted into thymidine mononucleotide phosphate or thymidine monophosphate. So the enzyme responsible for this is thymidylate synthesis. And what it does, it takes the methyl group from tetrahydrofolate and gets tetrahydrofolate converted into dihydrofolate. Now imagine dihydrofolate reducted as a garbage truck or a recycler. What it does is it changes the dihydrofolate back to the tetrahydrofolate, leading to a continuous cycle which gives a continuous supply of this substrate methyl donor to the thymidylate synthase, leading to continuous synthesis of mononucleotides. But methotrexate is going to inhibit this enzyme, which will lead to deficiency of tetrahydrofolate. If this is not being made back from dihydrofolate, this enzyme won't have enough substrate to work from, and hence this will be impaired. Synthesis of mononucleotide TMP will be impaired. Now this mononucleotide is responsible for the DNA synthesis in the end. So if this is not being made, DNA synthesis cannot occur. So this is how methotrexate inhibits DNA synthesis at the level of mononucleotide synthesis. Good one. Let's go to the next one. So the next one is that RNA polymerase B, the second one, is blocked due to a mannitine poisoning or poison of death cup. So they're asking, what does it disturb? So there are certain types of RNA polymerases responsible for transcription present in our body. In eukaryotes, all eukaryotes, there are the RNA polymerase 1, 2nd and 3rd. In plants, we have 4th and 5th as well. But in RNA polymerase 1 is responsible for synthesis of large RNAs. RNA polymerase 2, on other hand, is responsible for synthesis of preform of mRNAs. Preform means that before the post-transcriptional changes, like the cutting and splicing is not done with exon and introns both. And it also transcribes snRNAs and other forms of RNAs. RNA polymerase 3 is responsible for transcribing tRNAs, small rRNAs, and some snRNAs and other forms of RNA as well. The gist of this is that the first one forms large RNAs, the second one forms pre-mRNAs, and the third one forms tRNAs. So that's the basis of it, that RNA polymerase 2 will lead to, like, blocking of this enzyme will lead to disturbed synthesis of mRNA. So let's go to the next one. Okay, so in 8th question, we have that pain along the large nervous stems and increased amount of pyruvate in the blood were revealed in the patient. Insufficiency of what vitamin can cause these changes? So to understand that, we need to learn the coenzymic form of various vitamins. For example, in thymine or vitamin B1, we have thymine pyrophosphate. Riboflavin, we have FAD or FMN. Flavin, adenine dinucleotide, or flavin mononucleotide. Pyridoxine, vitamin B6, we have pyridoxal phosphate. Nicotinic acid, we have NAD and NADP+. And pantothenic acid, we have coenzyme A, biotin, biocytin, and so on. So these coenzyme form, they take part in various reactions given here. So for us right now, important is that in this patient, there is an increased amount of pyruvate. So keeping that in mind, let's go to what vitamin B1's coenzymic form, thymine pyrophosphate, is responsible for. It is responsible for many reactions. It serves as a cofactor in carbohydrate metabolism. So the most important enzyme which it acts as a cofactor for is pyruvate dehydrogenase. Pyruvate dehydrogenase complex is responsible for converting pyruvate to acetyl coenzyme. If this complex doesn't work, it will lead to accumulation of pyruvate, and if the thymine is not present in sufficient amount, so that this it cannot act as a cofactor for this enzyme, leading to its dysfunction, will lead to accumulation of pyruvate in the blood and hence the following symptoms. Thus, vitamin B1 is responsible for this cause. The next question we have is about a patient with encephalopathy. He was admitted to a neurological inpatient department. So, correlation of increasing encephalopathy substances absorbed by bloodstream from intestines were revealed. What substances are created in the intestine that can cause endotoxemia? So there are certain things that happen in the intestine, the large intestine specifically. Large intestine, we all know, is the home to bacteria or the microflora. So the bacteria in the intestine, they synthesize some products from the substances of the digestion which are not absorbed completely. So there are certain amino acids or carbs or fats which are not digested, and they are used by the bacteria to form certain products. Some of these products are very useful, like vitamin K is being synthesized, vitamin B12 is being synthesized by the bacteria in the intestine. Some alcohols are synthesized. Ammonia is being synthesized. But there are some toxic substances as well. So let's talk about the protein part of this enzyme of this bacterial digestion. So the protein putrefaction is the conversion of undigested proteins by the microflora of intestine. So the undegraded peptides and amino acids which are not absorbed, they undergo some reactions by the bacterial enzymes so that they form certain toxic compounds like phenol, cresol, indoles, catol, etc. and some non-toxic alcohols, hydroxy acids and fatty acids, which are absorbed back and used in our body. So these toxic substances and non-toxic substances formed by the bacteria are absorbed back in the large intestine and they enter the blood. So let's talk about some amino acids and their formed compound. So first we have tyrosine, which forms cresol, and phenol. Tryptophan forms catol and indole. Cysteine forms hydrogen sulfide, the gas. Phenylalanine forms benzoic acid and toluene. Ornithine and lysine forms putrescine and cadaverine. So now these toxic substances, they enter the blood and need to be detoxified into certain other substances. So these endotoxins, they go to the most important factory in our body, the liver. They undergo metabolism, they are detoxified in the liver, and they form certain substances which we can help analyze the toxic functions of the liver. We can analyze the amount of putrefaction going in the intestine, but that is a topic for another question. Here you can just see that these are the toxic compounds formed by protein putrefaction, and in the question, from all these substances, indole is the only substance which is formed due to protein putrefaction. So the next question we have is about tryptophan metabolism. So the examination of patients suffering from cancer of the urinary bladder revealed high rate of serotonin and hydroxyanthralic acid. So it is caused by excess of the following amino acid in the organism: tryptophan, alanine, histidine, methionine, tyrosine. So we need to know about some metabolism of these amino acid. So let's here focus about the metabolism tryptophan and see why the answer is tryptophan. So tryptophan undergoes a special type of metabolism where it has two or three pathways. First, you all know amino acid forms protein synthesis, that's out of question. The other pathway is the serotonin pathway or the kynurenine pathway. Now the ratio in which these pathways work is 99% to 1%. Most of the tryptophan goes into conversion and formation of nicotinic NAD, which is the coenzymic form of niacin. or nicotinamide, and 1% of tryptophan is used for serotonin and melatonin synthesis. So let's go back to the question. So there are high rate of serotonin and hydroxyanthralic acid. So from the question itself, you can find the answer that these two are synthesized from tryptophan. So there is a excess of tryptophan, but there is also cancer of the urinary bladder. So we need to connect these dots as well so that we have a better understanding. So tryptophan is metabolized through these three pathways. In the kynurenine pathway, there are certain compounds of the kynurenine pathway like 3-hydroxykynurenine, 3-hydroxyanthralic acid, quinolic acid, and so on. What these intermediate substances do, that these metabolites can interact with the nitrates present in the body to become mutagenic nitrosamines. So these mutagenic nitrosamines are toxic, are carcinogenic, which may cause cancers or disturbances in the body. Now the scientific research on this subject is very conflicting. Some scientists believe that this may occur more frequently. Some believe that it is not a common, but just like many other carcinogenic, it depends on genes and everything. But the thing is that kynurenine pathway, the intermediary products can form mutagenic nitrosamines, which can be the cause of bladder cancer in the patient of our question. So we have done this 10 questions of this space, guys. I would like to continue, but I think a 30 minute or 35 minute video is enough in one sitting for you guys. So we'll cover the next few questions in the next video. And before I end this video, I would like to say that we will be doing a quick revision series of the bases as well, so that you can just pick on the keywords and you can understand why the answers are just the way they are. But for that, we need to first learn the basics and the facts of biochemistry so that we understand the best basic knowledge which forms the question, why the answer is the answer of that question. So for that, we are doing this base series. If you really want the quick revision series with the this base series or before the base series as fast as I can, then please mention it in the comments. And also please don't forget to subscribe the channel and sharing the channel with your friends. It would be a great boon for the channel and it would be beneficial for your friends too. So I think that's all. This is Pirates of Medicine. This has been great. See you in the next one. Goodbye.